Hello everyone, my name is Jack Haslam and I'm going to speak to you about cultural control methods for thrips. So first of all, what are thrips? Thrips are tiny insects, often about a millimetre long. They generally feed on plants, but they're also predatory thrips. They have mouthpieces that are adapted to puncture and suck up the contents of cells, and will target different areas of the plant depending on different species. As you can see by the image on the right, so they have long, skinny bodies that's both as a larva as an adult. The only real obvious difference is that larvae don't have wings, but even the adult wings aren't particularly conspicuous, and they're not very strong flyers, and so they rely on wind for long range dispersal. But not all species are bad. Some are relied on for pollination, some fulfill important roles for control of other thrip species and other pests. And the first fossil evidence of plant pollination by an insect is actually from a thrips about 100 million years ago. So why are they important to growers? They're one of the primary pests of almost all different crops within horticulture. The major issue for ornamentals is they're a visual contaminant, so they cause silver speckling on leaves, as you can see on the image, and that's why they've sucked all of the contents out of the cells, leaving them in that sort of pale whitish colour. And in more intense levels of infection, they can cause browning and discoloration of flowers and fruits, which obviously isn't great if you're trying to market them. For food crops, they reduce plant vigour, cause stunted growth and leaf and bud distortion, mean that your yields are inhibited, and then most significantly is that they also are one of the main vectors for plant viruses, so much so that there's a specific group of viruses that are transmitted exclusively by thrips, known as tossball viruses. So the first place to start when thinking about controlling a pest is actually understanding the pest that you're dealing with. So their general life cycle is that they have eggs that are laid in foliage where the larvae will hatch and feed. Depending on the specific type of thrips, there will be different areas that they prefer to lay their eggs, but this damage by the larvae is what causes that silver speckling that I mentioned previously, and also can cause discoloration in flowers and also on fruit. Once the larvae have eaten enough and sufficiently developed, they enter the pupal stage where they will fall off the plant to the soil, and they won't feed in the soil, they'll just develop in the soil into adults. So you have the initial pre-pupa in the growing media, pupa there, and then once they are developed into adults, they'll emerge with wings and they will fly back up into the foliage and continue to feed. They can have up to about 8 generations per year. An egg to adult may be completed in a shorter time as 2 weeks, but this is very temperature dependent. Lower temperatures, the number of generations can be massively reduced. And then over winter, they will lay dormant in either soil or plant debris, again, depending on the species. So just wanted to mention a few of the key species of economic importance for growers. So first of all is the western flower thrips. It's non-native, it's originally from southwest USA, has a very wide host range and is especially attracted to flowers and young fruits, and has quite a high level of resistance to chemical pesticides, so it can be a big problem for growers. The next species I want to talk about is the onion thrips. So this is native to the UK, can be seen in very, very high populations, especially outdoors in field veg or also hardy nursery stock. Again, has a very wide range, but the onion thrips prefers foliage, so leaves really, more than flowers. Then finally is a relatively new thrips species to the UK, is the Japanese flower thrips that came from Japan. It was first identified in the UK in 2016, but has become an increasingly big problem, and again has a very wide host range but prefers leaves like the onion thrips rather than the western flower thrips. So now we know a little bit more about what we're dealing with. The first consideration when considering cultural controls has to be site selection. You ideally want to minimize the amount of the pest that will be coming in. As I mentioned earlier, thrips are weak flyers, and so they're moved by wind. They tend to accumulate in crop fields, in hedgerows, and in wildflower margins, and they'll only attempt to leave the area if the food becomes scarce, such as in hot and dry conditions. But they can be easily moved by wind during crop harvesting, or if there's grassland management, so if the grass is being cut. So it's very important to understand the immediate environment to your facility. If your facility is close to big fields of wheat, barley, or grasslands, then you will be more at risk of thrips entering. And so you need to just be conscious of that. But equally, are you able to harness your environment by attracting beneficials and getting that natural control? So although thrips like wildflowers, so do a lot of their predators. And so thinking about actually within your facility, if you're able to maybe have hedgerows or wildflower margins that are able to provide you some natural support. The next consideration is crop selection when thinking about cultural controls. Full resistance to thrips in a variety is very difficult because of their feeding ecology. It's hard to stop them getting onto the plant and boring into the cells, but some crops and varieties are less attractive than others, and if you can make them less attractive to your plant, then they're more likely to go to maybe a non-crop plant and attack that first. It's kind of key resistant mechanisms of plants. So you've got the crop morphology, the actual, so if it's a thrips that likes more densely foliated plants, then that might be something that attracts them. So maybe you can consider a variety that has less dense foliage. Does your plant produce unattractive metabolites? So for example, garlic is very unattractive to thrips, but also you can get some chili plants that will produce specific metabolites that certain species of thrips don't like. But then also crop physiology and development. So thrips might like to attack certain species at certain stages in their development. If you can find a variety that doesn't linger at that stage quite as long, then that could be something beneficial. But what's important to consider is that resilience for one species of thrips does not mean resilience for all species of thrips. So what might make a certain variety not attractive to western flower thrips could make it quite attractive to onion thrips. And so you need to know what species that you're trying to keep away, and then you can start with selecting the correct variety. But a general good sort of rule of thumb is that if you grow multiple varieties of the same crop, which I appreciate isn't always possible, but if you can, then that will provide protection, because there'll be some species more resilient than others, and it'll stop the thrips being able to establish in quite the same way as if it was a complete monocrop. The next consideration is the growing environment. So the environment type is obviously going to influence prevalence, considering they're coming from the areas that I mentioned previously. So if you're growing in a field, like on the image, then you're going to be the most at risk of thrips getting in because you're fully exposed. But you also will have a higher level of natural control due to the surrounding environment, and will have more alternative options for thrips to attack. And so if you select varieties that are resistant, that thrips can be less attracted to, then they might decide to move away and go to non-crop species nearby. Polytunnel, you're going to have cover which will afford some protection, but you do still have that exposure. But again, there'll still be some natural control and some alternate options, but you need to be conscious of that. And then glasshouse, It's the best option for limited exposure to the outside environment. You've only got small areas that the thrips can get in. But the major consideration is that the warm environment within the glasshouse, the reduced natural control, and also the low species diversity you see in there can lead to faster outbreaks. So once they're in, it can become more severe more quickly. I think it's best practice with glasshouses to be aware of your surroundings and close your vents, which are downwind from areas such as farmers' fields when they're harvesting in those high risk periods, and be conscious of that to reduce the amount that are going to come in. So if you have done all the above but you still have thrips in your crop, then it's very important to make sure that you're monitoring their population and IDing which ones they are. So the key things to look out for is damage. So if there's foliar damage, that's silvering that I showed in the second slide, which is what you see at medium intensity of the pest, but then you can also see browning and distortion of leaves, flowers and fruit at higher levels of pest intensity. So again, with the flowers you can see a silver speckling or browning, and then a final thing to keep an eye out for with regards to damage is viruses. So as I mentioned, the specific group of viruses called tospoviruses that are spread exclusively by thrips. And so if you look out on your crop and see the symptoms of them, then it suggests that it's thrips. So this on the right is a tomato plant that has tomato spotted wilt virus, which is spread by thrips. And then if you go on crop walks, one way to just look at them on the plant is that thrips are not very tightly held to the crop like an aphid or a scale insect. So what you can do is disturb the foliage with your hand or with a pen and put a sheet of paper below and see what falls onto it. And thrips will generally fall out, and so that'll give you a good idea of the intensity of the infection. The next way to keep an eye out for thrips once you know they're in your crop, but equally would recommend doing this preventively anyway, is using sticky traps. They're an effective method of monitoring thrips, but they can be a little bit less accurate for intensity. Blue sticky traps have traditionally been used, but there is evidence now suggesting that thrips actually prefer a contrasting colour. So as you can see on the right here, a yellow sticky trap next to a blue sticky trap actually might be better for attracting more thrips. And you can boost that level of attraction using attractant chemicals, which are on the market, specific ones for thrips. And they can increase the amount caught and reduce pressure in your crop. So you're getting some level of control even from monitoring. And also placement within the crop. So depending on the thrip species and the type of crop that you're working with, but that can actually impact the level of thrips. So if you have it within the foliage, above the foliage, below the foliage, it can depend. And you can even put some sideways below the foliage to catch the pupa, below the foliage to catch some pupa, which will fall once they enter that stage, to give you a better idea of the life stage that the thrips are at. And once you have an idea about the sort of presence in your crop, then it's possible to monitor populations within your own crop using growing degree hours calculation. So this uses temperature to estimate the development speed and therefore the growth of population, and can allow you to get a better handle on the level of pest intensity. So what this requires is you to be accurately measuring temperature within the crop. You need to know the thrip species you're dealing with and what their base temperature is, so that's the temperature at which their development will begin. And then you also need to know the development speed, so how many growing degree hours there will be until emergence. So you can use the below calculation. Once you get to that level, you can have an idea about when the thrips are going to start emerging. You're going to start to see that pressure on your crop. So beyond monitoring, if you want to look at starting to really control the thrips, then one of the best things you can do is ensure that you've got good crop hygiene. So your activities before and during the crop are of paramount importance. If you're growing a crop, especially in protection, where you will have periods where you're completely removing the crop, as you can see there with the tomato on the right, then it's very important to disinfect and make sure you get good coverage around the glasshouse or the polytunnel, using an appropriate disinfectant, and that will kill overwintering thrips and that will vastly reduce pressure when the temperature increases. Also removing debris, so thrips overwinter in debris, and so removal of it will again vastly reduce the amount of thrips present and mean that next year when the temperatures heat up, then there's the level of thrips in your growing environment will be massively reduced. And then finally, thinking about green bridges. So green bridges is a plant that will facilitate the movement of thrips from the environment into your crop. So certain plant species can act as a conduit for thrips infection. So if you're in a protected environment, then it's advised to remove them. Or if you're in a field environment, then think about the crop species that you're growing and attempt not to cultivate similar weeds in field margin. So having a bit of an understanding about the different weeds in the field margin and what relation they have to your crop can go a long way. So for example, if you're in the field growing crops with large flowers, maybe members of the Asteraceae family, then think about removing your ragworts and corn marigolds, things like that. In protection, environmental regulation is very important. So temperature really is key when you're managing thrips. Even small increase in temperature can have exponential impact on the thrips population. So you can see this chart below, and it shows the thrips palmae, six different temperatures and the speed of development in days between them. So you can see at 16 degrees, the egg takes 12, almost 13 days to develop. At 31 degrees, that falls down to 3.2. So egg to adult, for example, is 36 days at 16 degrees and is less than 10 days at 31. And so the speed of development will mean that the speed of the population growth also is mirror the speed of the population growth, and so keeping your temperature down to as low as is possible, obviously it's important for plant development, so it's something you need to consider, but that will help you minimize thrips populations. Also, they don't like humidity, so if you can have higher humidity, then that's preferable, but equally it's important to manage that because it's a trade-off against diseases like botrytis, for example, or mildews, which like higher humidity. Companion cropping is another good method of culturally reducing the risk of your crops of thrips. So one of those things is intercropping, and that's where you plant within your crop. So a good example of this being successful is a study by the HDB, which found that intercropping leeks with clover reduced onion thrips populations by 50%, and that obviously will have a significant knock-on on the damage to your crop or reduction in damage to your crop. Trapping with plants is an important one, so western flower thrips are attracted to flowers, and so using chrysanthemums within your crop, especially in protection, can be effective at directing thrips away from your crop and onto the traps. Bankers are always a useful tool, so alyssum and aubergine are good crops to provide an environment that enables natural enemies of thrips to develop. And then finally, repellent. So as I mentioned earlier, garlic is a very good one, but yeah, any plant that produces unattractive compounds to thrips, so they can be planted with the crop to provide protection. But using these methods, it's very important to understand the ecology of the specific thrip species that you're working with. So if you're using onion thrips, then they might not be as attracted to chrysanthemums, or there might be specific thrips that don't like garlic, but there's other ones which do. So you need to understand what you're working with and then find the appropriate companion cropping method to manage that. And finally, for field crops, fostering natural controls is a very useful way of reducing it. Pressure from thrips. So you can use field margins with wildflowers and hedges, and they can be a useful source of things like ground beetles and spiders, which will predate thrips pupae on the ground, or Chrysopelecarnea, the green lacewing, which has larvae that are very effective predators within foliage. So if you understand the ecology of how the ground beetles and spiders work and which types of plants are beneficial for them, then that can help. Or it's this nice graphic that I've got on the right here, which shows pollen consumed by green lacewings and when these specific groups or these specific families of weeds are producing that pollen. So getting a nice diversity of these different weeds so that the green lacewing always has pollen to consume, and so the population is able to be sustained, can make sure that you have high levels of natural control. And that's everything that I wanted to talk about today. So thank you very much. And if anyone does have any questions, anything that I've covered, then please feel free to get in touch.